Back in time, you're not from San Antonio, actually. Where are you from, sir?
I'm from a little town in central Texas called Granger. For those of you that are familiar with the Austin area, it's up 35 or 81 going toward Dallas, and it's about 20 miles northeast of Round Rock or Georgetown, Texas.
Okay, that's a little way.
Cotton-picking country.
A cotton-picking country.
Yes.
I only seen cotton one time.
Right.
Well, one time, and my brother-in-law was driving along in Alabama, let me get out and pick some.
Well, I saw so much cotton until when I first come to San Antonio, I wouldn't even buy a cotton shirt.
You wouldn't buy
it? I was so tired of picking cotton.
I can only imagine.
Yes, it's a tough job.
It's a tough job.
Yeah, but it wasn't all bad. You know, you do what you have to do, and an old saying, you can't miss something you never had. That was a way of life, and it was okay. You know, I was making a decent living, and I stayed there until after I finished high school and went off to Barber College up in East Texas. And then from there, I moved to San Antonio.
Well, can we just go back a little bit? Because I want to talk about, you said it wasn't half bad, but you came along a time of a lot of racism and a lot of prejudice and the segregation and things of that nature. And many times, let me put it like this, they don't have them in our history books anymore. And so in order for us to preserve our history, we have to tell our story a lot of times, and we have to tell it over and over. As they delete it, we have to still tell it again.
Absolutely.
So can you just give me a little background of what that was like, going to school in Texas at Granger, in Granger, a small town, and then during the time that you came up, what was it really like?
Well, you know, you can't miss something you never had.
Mm-hmm.
When I look back on it, yes, it was difficult times, but in the midst of that time,
mm-hmm.
It was not so bad. You do what you have to do. I was in a community of doers, a community mm-hmm. of lovers, and I was in a community where parenting was the whole community. Everybody mm-hmm. was your mom and dad, so you had to be careful what you do and what you say. But as far as the work and the treatment was concerned, mm-hmm. yeah, it was tough. It was hard. It really was. But you know, sometimes when you go through trying times and you come out of it, it makes you a stronger person, mm-hmm. makes you more appreciative of who you are and what you have, and give you a better understanding of what life really is and the true meaning of it when you've seen both sides. And what I mean by that, yeah, we were treated sometimes less than citizens. We were called the N-word, or the N-word was used around us without, you know, any respect for you. As a kid growing up, though, I lived with my aunt, who really I call mom. My mother, biological mom, passed when I was 2 years old. And my dad's oldest sister took my brother and I in, and that's the only mama that I know. Interesting story about that. I didn't know that until I was about 6 years old, getting ready to go to school. And I don't know, we were playing and talking one day, and he told me, he said, you know, mama's really not our mama. I said, what are you talking about, man? You crazy. He said, no, that's our aunt, you know. So when I got a chance, I said, mama, Sonny told me you're not my mama. And she said, well, sit down. Let me tell you something. And I sit on the side of the bed with her. She said, no, I'm not. Said, Joe, your mother passed when you was two, and you and Sonny live with my mom and dad for a while, which is our grandparent, and you live with our auntie, and then sometime you would stay with your dad. And she said, I just got tired of y'all moving from one family to another, and I decided I'm going to take these boys and raise them. She said, so you've been with me basically ever since you was about two or two and a half. And then she looked at me, she said, but damn it, I am your mama. And don't you ever forget that, you
right.
know. And I was pleased, very pleased with her to say that. And of course, I wouldn't admit it then, but I really was a mama's boy. And she took me and nurtured me and raised me. But we called her First Sergeant because she didn't play, man.
She was a
strong disciplinarian. And some of the things that I do, well, let me back that up. I am today who I am mainly because of a lady called Marcelle Axel.
Mm-hmm.
That was my mom. That was the lady that raised me. And the entrepreneurial spirit was planted in me by her. Mm-hmm. And I was too young to know that and to realize that. But as time passed on, and I began to question why I wanted to do certain things, why I had an urge to do things and think outside of the box, it went back to Massey Lee. Think about it. 80 years ago, here's a black woman owning not one house, but two houses in difficult times, against the odds. Mm-hmm. So you see, I was raised by someone who was an entrepreneur in her own way, you see. Mm-hmm. She was dubbed and was known as the cook in Williamson County. That's what she did. She cooked for white people, clean houses and that type thing. Mm-hmm. But she did it well, and she did it kind of independently because she, even though that's what she was doing, she let them know that this is my job and you stay out of the way until I finish. If you got any complaints, you tell me after I finish. That's right, kind of, and she meant that, you know. That's kind of the way she was. And then she taught me business skills again without me realizing what was going on. I remember when I was about 13, she called me into the kitchen one day and she pulled the door back. And when she pulled the door back, that was about five or six envelopes on the door. And she said, now, this envelope is to pay the gas and light bill. This envelope is to pay the water bill. This envelope here is to buy groceries. This envelope here is to pay the household bills. And I'm going to put money in there. And she looked at me, she said, and your job is to make sure that these bills are paid. You got it? I said, yes, Mom. She said, well, let's go over. She said, this is the water bill, this is the light bill, this is the insurance bill, and da-da-da, and et cetera. I said, okay, Mom, I got it. Well, like a teenager would do, I got busy playing one time, forgot to pay one of those bills.
Oh, boy.
Yes, yeah. And it was the bill on the Singer sewing machine. She had bought a brand new electric Singer sewing machine. She had used one of those with the foot pedal. And she had graduated up to the point where she had bought her an electric Singer sewing machine. And I got busy and missed one of those payments. Well, the gentleman showed up to collect his money. And she said, oh, no, you must be mistaken. I don't owe you any money. My bills are always paid on time. He said, well, no, Miss Massey, I can see you skipped months, so and so and so and so. And I'm listening. I said, oh, my God, I forgot to pay that bill. And she went back there and looked. And she said, oh, okay, okay. She said, well, here's your money, sir. She looked at me and said, we're going to talk later. I was scared to death.
I know you were.
Yes, I was scared to death. So
oh, my goodness.
She paid him, and he said, okay, you paid up for 2 months now. I said, I'll see. She said, oh, you want to see me? I said, your money going to be in the office from now on. I guarantee you that. He said, okay, yes, ma'am. She said, but again, you're in good standing. You don't have to worry about it. So when he left, man, she looked at me and begged for me and commenced taking care of business. I mean, giving me a whipping like I never had before. And if the whipping wasn't bad enough, I was lectured to for the rest of the evening and most of the night so that I would not ever, ever make that mistake again, and I didn't. But what I'm saying is she was teaching me business principles to be responsible and take care of my bills, at age 13. So that grew on me as a part of me growing up in Granger, Texas, yeah.
Awesome story. I just love that story, and I wish we had more parents that would do that today. Amen, because she taught you integrity. She taught you how to manage money. She taught you business, and she taught you accountability, and she taught you how to really let people know they can count on you.
That is awesome.
Well, that tells me why you are who you are today, right? Well, there, that just tells me everything.
She played a big part in it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you left Granger, Texas, and what happened when you came? Where did you go?
After I finished high school, I went to Austin, Texas.
Okay.
Stayed in Austin for about 3 or 4 months. Working, trying to get some money so that I could go to barber college. All the time I was in high school, I just knew and thought that I would be a coach. I loved my basketball coach and my football coach. Mm-hmm. But I didn't get a scholarship, and mom didn't have the money to send me. So it was my basketball coach. She told me, said, well, Charles, why don't you, you've been cutting hair around here, so why don't you go to barber college, learn you a trade. You can work your trade during the day, and then at night you can go to college. Well, it sounded like a good plan to me.
Yeah.
I said, okay. I said, okay, yeah. we'll do that. So I know now that that's what I'm going to end up doing, so now I got to go make some money so that I'll be able to do this. So I left home and went to Austin and stayed with a cousin of mine, and never will forget. We lived on, stayed on 12th and Chacon, right there in Austin, Texas, for about 4 months. And I looked for a job for about a week and a half before a job found me. I was standing in front of a clothing store on Congress, and had beautiful shoes and shirts, and I've always loved nice clothes. And I was looking at it, and this gentleman walked up, and we just started talking. He said, man, I said, man, that's a pretty shirt over there. He said, yeah. And I said, hey, look at those shoes. He said, yeah. And he said, by the way, you want a job? You looking for a job? And this is where God plays a part in your life, because I was at the point where I was almost ready to go back home and do some rough work in order to get some money to at least to get started. And I didn't know whether or not I was going to make enough to pay for the full tuition or not. But anyway, he said, you want a job? And I said, yeah. He said, you don't mind washing dishes? I said, man, I just want a decent job. I'll wash dishes. So he said, come on, let's go. Put me to work that same day. He was working at the Commodore Perry Hotel there on 8th and Brazos in Austin, Texas. And I started working that day, and I worked there for about 3 months until almost four, until September rolled around, time to go off to. By that time, I had saved up enough money to pay the initial tuition and 4 months in advance. And that time, Bible College was only 6 months, so I just had 2 months to worry about. So I went on up there, paid my tuition and everything, and he said, and my coach said, well, I'll help you when I can. My brother was in the service, and he said, well, Charles, I'll send you some money, and he did. But I was only there for maybe a week and a half, and I said, well, okay, I know how to wash dishes. I'll go around here to this hotel and get me a job washing dishes. So I went around there and I asked the guy, I said, I'm looking for a job. Are y'all hiring? And he looked at me, he said, yeah, we got a dishwashing job available. and I said, he said, if you don't, I went, well, I was gone this time. I said, well, I'd like to wait tables, you know? Mm-hmm. And he said, no, I got a dishwashing job. I said, I'll take it. So I did. I took the job as a dishwasher there at the big hotel of Blackshear, I think it was. That's where all the businessmen, cattlemen, and all men from East Texas would come to that part of Texas for conventions and things. We had a big convention about 10 days after I started working there. And I looked over one day and the chef was in trouble. And I just jumped over and started, finished off the mashed potatoes. I finished the greens up for him, seasoned the roast, and I never will forget, put it in the oven and everything. And he just kind of looked up at me. So at the end of the day, he said, hey, boy, where'd you learn to cook like that? And I said, well, the little that I know, my mom taught me. So he said, well, I'll tell you what, tomorrow when you come, you hang that dishwashing apron over there and you come get your jacket. I'm going to talk to the chef.
Look at God.
I'm going to take the chef. And
yes,
so I ended up being the cook's help, which increased my salary. So now I don't have to worry about these two months.
Yeah,
I'm making me some money now. Yeah. So, and I did that until I graduated from Barber College. And when I got ready to leave, he did not want, he said, can't you just stay a couple of more months? I said, no, I got to go.
Right.
I got to go home
and wait for
my license, and then I got to get out there and look for me a job as a barber. So that's kind of how that happened, from high school transition, Austin, and then getting my license, and then coming. I had a friend that was going to barber college with me. And He was from Oklahoma. He was a little town called Okamugi, but his uncle had a big shop in Oklahoma City. And he said, Charles, back then we didn't have cell. Matter of fact, we didn't have telephones. And he kept writing me saying, Charles, we're saving a chair for you. My uncle's out of convincing him to save a chair for you. So I was bailed out. I just knew I was going to go to Oklahoma. But when I got my license, my mom and my other auntie kind of teamed up on me and said, well, she said, well, baby, I just don't want you to go to Oklahoma. That's too far. Well, for her, 450 miles was too far away. Austin was only 150 miles, you see. I mean, San Antonio was only 50 miles. So they convinced me. She said, well, I tell you what. If you go to San Antonio, give it a hard try for 2 months, and if you don't like it, then I won't say anything if you want to go to Oklahoma. I said, okay, that sounds like a deal. Well, 2 months turned into 65 years.
Beautiful.
By the grace of God and honing my skills, I come here and I joined one of the leading barbershops in this city, Taylor's Barbershop, and didn't know, but at that time it had some of the best barbers in Texas, not only in San Antonio. Mr. Burl Graves, Caleb Brave, his brother, Paul White, who was the shop manager. There was a lady working there by the name of Taylor. And the lady that owned the shop was Mrs. Verley Taylor. And I like to tell this part of the story because it truly let me know that God was with me from birth until this day, every step of the way. And everything that I asked for, looked for, eventually fell in my lap, or at least it came to me. And I was working there at Mrs. Verley Taylor's shop with these guys. And these guys were terrific barbers. They were just good. And they had a high level of professionalism. You didn't do a whole lot of swearing and cursing at Taylor's barbershop.
That's good.
We didn't even play games. We didn't play dominoes and checkers and that type thing, you know? And he suggested in your downtime when you're not, grab your book and read so you can learn.
That's right.
And that's what Mr. White suggested. And then, of course, they were all busy, you know. And I said one day, I said, wow, this is a nice building, two-story building and everything. I said, who owned this building? They said, Dr. Preacher. I said, you mean that black doctor that goes up? They said, yeah, this is his building. Well, I found out that he was the first black man to build a two-story commercial building on Commerce Street. And it still stands today.
And
it was called the Preacher Professional Building because his name was Madison L. Preacher. Well, Mrs. Verley Taylor leased the spot in there for the barbershop, and that's how it ended up being called Taylor's Barbershop. And then I started questioning, well, where is Miss Taylor? Well, she was sick. And they hired me. She was sick, and she had cancer in it at the time, and I didn't know it, but I wanted to sit. And he said, well, no, she's not taking any. A month after I started working there, Miss Taylor passed. So I never got a chance to meet the lady that provided a space for me to launch my barbering career. And for 60-some years, I always wondered what it would be like to have a conversation with her when she was a young barber and why she put up one of the largest shops in the city. And not only did she have a barbershop, she also owned the Manhattan Hotel, which was down in the next block. She bought a three-story Victorian house and converted it to a hotel, and it was called the Manhattan Hotel. So I just was in awe about this lady was able to do that and never got a chance to meet her. And I just said, well, that's just one of those things. I just have to find out as much about it as I could. And nobody really knew a whole lot about it except for Mr. White, who was a shop manager. And he would give me bits and pieces about her and how she started and everything. Well, from that, I went on from a barber to owning my own shop, moved down in the next block, opened up my first shop, little three-chair shop. I bought it from a Spanish gentleman, and 85%, 95% of his customers were a mixture of whites and browns, Mexican Americans and whites. And I thought, well, okay, I'm breaking new territory here. And he told me, he said, I want you to have this shop. You can, I know you, Charles, you can do. And I would stop and talk to him because his shop was next door to a 24-hour eatery called the Lifesaver Grill.
Okay.
So when I would go to Lifesaver for lunch, I would stop and talk to Manuel. Manuel Gonzalez was his name. And then one day I was on my way, and he said, Charles, when you come back from lunch, he said, stop in, I want to chat with you. So I went on, finished my lunch, come back. He said, Charles, I'm getting ready to sell this shop. And I want to sell it to you.
Awesome.
And I said, Manuel, and at that point, I'd been working about 6 years at Tails and been saving my money pretty good. And I said, well, Manuel, I don't know whether I can handle it. I don't know whether I have enough money. He said, oh, I'm going to make it possible for you to have it. He said, you're a nice young man, and I like you. And people in this community like you. They already talking about you. He said, in a good way. So I said, well, okay. I said, I've been thinking about my own shop, and I'll give it a shot. So he did. He fixed it well. I could handle it, the price and everything. So I moved in. My manager, Mr. White, was not too happy when I told him I was leaving to open up my own shop. But almost the other barbers gave me their blessings, you know, and later on, Mr. White did. But I can understand his position, you know, everything.
He's so, losing one of his top barbers.
Yes, because I had developed as one of the top barbers at the time that I left there. So I was concerned about how many of my customers were going to follow me. And I give no thought about the rest of the situation. I was just concerned about. So I said, well, I'm going on. I know at least 60% of them are going to follow me, and that's enough for me to survive on. Well, I moved in there, and it just blew me away when my customers started coming. So I carried over about 98% of my customers and took about 10% of their customers. And I wasn't expecting that. That shocked me because these guys were good.
Yeah.
And I know that's why Mr. White didn't want me to leave, because he probably figured, I didn't know that, but he's going to take some of the shop customers. And I did. And not bodaciously and not bragging, but that's just the way it happened, you see. So now I'm in my first shop. I started out a little two-chair shop. And then another guy approached me and said, Charles, I want to work with you. I said, man, your name is the buzzword on the street. That's this young barber that opened up the shop. He's really good, and customers are just flocking to his shop. And he said, Tinsley, I don't have a chair right now. He said, well, how long you think? I said, well, I don't know. I said, but I tell you what, you'll be the first. When I get the chair, you'll be the first. Now, I'm in the shop now only about 3 months, and here's somebody want to come work with me who've been working across the street for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So now that I think back on it, it spoke volumes from. But then I just said, wonder why he want to come over. He'd been over there for 10 years, but he could see what was going on.
Right,
he could see the change, and he could see a new attitude in the industry, you see. So I'm concentrating on how I'm going to get this other chair. Now, mind you, I'm talking 60, but at this point, about 50-some years ago. And the chair at that time was about $175. And I started praying, well, okay, I got to save up the money to get this extra chair. About 10 days after that transaction and our conversation, and I then went and found the chair and found out how much it was, a deacon from my church come. I'd never cut his hair before, knew him, we had good conversation. And his name was Ross. And he walked in and said, come on, Brother William, give me a haircut. And I said, oh, thank you. And I was delighted to be able to work on Brother Ross because he was so knowledgeable and one of the lead deacons at Mount Zion Ferry Baptist Church right down the street. And I cut his hair and everything. He never cut his hair. And I was a little nervous because I said, man, I got to get this man a good haircut. Haircuts at that time was probably about $5. So when he got up, he said, how much owe you, Brother William? And I said, $5. And he wrote me a check. Well, normally, I would just fold a check up and put it in my jacket pocket. But for some reason or another, mind you now, the chair that I was going to buy was $75, $175. So I went to fold it up and I looked at it and the check was for $175.
My God, look at God. Won't he do it?
I just kind of froze.
Awesome.
I just kind of froze and I said, Brother Ross, you made a mistake. He said, no, I didn't. Take the money, boy, and pay me when you can. And walked out the shop.
Look at God.
And I just sat down and cried. I just couldn't hold it, you know.
I bet. You know, that goes the whole truth that God says that he will allow us to do great exploits for those that trust in him. Your whole life has been a faith walk.
Yes.
And he said, I'll supply every need according to his riches and glory. Yes. That's what he said.
Yes. Yes.
And he promised us that. And so I'm just listening to you. And normally, yeah, I'm really talking, but you got a lot of history. This man is so knowledgeable and he's accomplished so many things. We will never get it done in this one interview. And maybe sometime later. Later, he'll come back and help me do the rest of it. But at any rate, you know, you are such an inspiration. And as those who are listening, I want you to know that we can accomplish anything if we just trust God to be able to do that for us. But we have to put the work in.
Yes.
And I'm noticing every step of the way, even though you're like, where am I going to get this money from? But you're still working with what you
every
got.
Day.
You're still
every
working
day.
With what
every
you
day.
Got every
yes.
day.
Yes.
And
yes.
you're still doing that. I'm
yes.
watching
yes.
you today.
Yes.
You
yes,
still
yes,
do that.
Yes.
But that is an
still
awesome
concerned
story.
About where I'm going to get the money to pay for this. But somehow it comes.
But somehow he...
Yeah, it gets a little close sometimes, but somehow it comes.
He caused it to manifest.
Yeah.
So you were telling us that you got bought the chair. Going
bought
right
the
here.
Chair, then mm-hmm. I called Mr. Tinksley, and he said, oh, man, well, I'll be there Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
So he come over and started working. Of course, the gentleman he was working for was a little angry with me. That's kind of when we call it envy and player haters nowadays, but anyway, I refused to let him be angry with me, mm-hmm. and I went and told him, I said, Mr. Miller, I didn't approach Mr. Tinksley. Mm-hmm. Mr. Tinksley approached me, and I told him, you know, I had to buy a chair, and when I got the chair, I let him know. I said, but I did not come to your shop trying to solicit to take one of your barbers away,
right.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to know that because I have a lot of respect for you, and
right.
I did.
Right.
And he looked at me and he said, well, I appreciate that, young man. He said, that shows a lot of courage and strength and manhood for you to come talk. I said, because I want you to know. I'm not going to let you be angry with me, you know.
Right, right.
And he shook my hand and hugged me, and then we just moved on from there and we're friends. It was then and there when I learned that you cannot help other people without helping yourself.
Absolutely.
Now, if you transform the scripture,
mm-hmm.
that just simply meant do unto others you have others
do
unto you.
Mm-hmm.
And it also says God bless you to be a blessing.
That's right.
You see?
That's right.
So now I'm thankful that I got three barbers in there, the shop just buzzing, we busy. And mind you, I'm talking way back at a time when blacks had menial jobs, but somehow we stayed busy all day. Somehow they would come to that shop from 8 o'clock in the morning, and we would close at 6, 7 o'clock in the evening, and we stayed busy. And then on Saturdays, we were just extremely busy.
I know.
So,
yeah, they probably out the door, right?
Yes, sending the calls,
yeah.
waiting, you see.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it was really a blessing. And at the same time, I felt very good about what was happening and the respect that I was beginning to gain from community leaders and businessmen. And then they would begin to seek me out and come. Mr. S.J. Davis on that wall right behind you was a real estate guy. And, you know, I didn't have no problem with it. Boy, just keep doing what you're doing. You're a good young man, you're a strong young man, and I'm gonna help you as much as I could. And then I started gathering customers in the professional and the business world. Then the teachers and the doctors and the preachers started coming to me. And that really kind of, I was probably the youngest.
The scripture puts it like this, I'll give you favor with God and man.
Yes. Well, I didn't know that then,
yeah,
you see.
Yeah.
And, they had also made me president of the Barbers Association, the Black Barbers Association, the San Antonio branch of the state chapter. And they were all excited about me being the president, just But the minute that they thought that I was moving ahead of them, then they started kind of backing off and fighting me and saying ugly things about me, you know. But I had tough skin, and my mom told me that in life, everybody you think's your friend is really not your friend. And just mm-hmm. for a little while, you'll find out. And that kind of come to me when that started happening, you know. But because I was able to attract professional men and women who could afford to pay me a little bit more money, I raised my prices. Mm-hmm. And oh my God, you would have thought that I had said something real ugly to my professional barber folk. They really got mad with me. Now I'm going like, well, I'm setting the bar for you.
Right.
I'm not like cutting the prices. I could understand if you'd be mad with me because I'm undercutting you. Mm-hmm. But I'm raising the prices. And I didn't know, but Burl, who was one of the good barbers at Taylor's Barbershop, told me when he said, the problem is, Charles, they can't reach where you are and they're mad about it. I said, well, I can't help that. I'm just being
me
and doing what I know to do and trying to keep in pace and reach the desire of my customers. At the same time, I had put in, back then we had ceiling fans in most of the barber shops, and we had water coolers in the windows. I don't know whether you remember this term or not, Ron might be, but we call them swamp fans.
Okay.
Because you hook up a water hose to it, uh-huh. and you turn the water on, and it would blow cool air. But after a while, things like your shoes and stuff like that would mildew because of that humidity, you see, mm-hmm. and there was no way to pull it out.
Right, right.
So then, after I raised my prices, I put in a big Frederick refrigerated air conditioning unit. Oh, boy. That's when the talk really hit the street. Joskis was a department store downtown where you could go in there, and when you open the door, that cold air would just hit you in the face. So the word on the streets was, man, when you go to William Barbershop, it's just like walking in Joskis, man. He's got that cold air up in there, you know? So all of that attracted customers, and then and so that started the conversation. Well, he thinks he's better than us. And I have never felt like that. I have never felt like that about anybody. I'm just who I am.
Amen.
And I thank God for...
Mr. Williams, we have about half an hour left, and I want to talk a little more about how you got to where you are today. You haven't stopped. You just stopped, put down one thing, and kept going. You've trained people. You've employed people. Mm-hmm. You've been a trendsetter in this city. You have opened doors for people. And when you finished, and you're a cook, you do artistry, you do woodworking. Is there anything you don't do, first of all, sir, before I go ahead?
Well,
by the way, y'all, I just need to tell y'all, for San Antonio's, or if you're passing through San Antonio, you need to stop by 502 Montana Road here in San Antonio on Saturdays between 11 and 4, I believe it is. You will eat the best fish ever you have ever eaten in your entire life if you stop by Mr. Williams.
Don't forget about the brisket and the ribs.
And he cooks briskets and he cooks ribs. I just love fish, and I'll come get the fish. But he cooks it all, and it's all delicious. And he has these beautiful ladies and people who wait on you with such wonderful personalities. And it just sets your whole day. It just makes it beautiful. And you're good to go for the whole day. You're different. I want to tell you, he's got a nice table here, or you can get it to go. The food is delicious. It's a very beautiful place. And here in the museum, and you can see the artifacts that he has and the things that he have that he can explain to you about the history, black history in particular, here in San Antonio. He has preserved it. But he had a dream before this came to reality. He had a dream. And tell us about that dream, Mr. Williams.
Well, there's a quote up there on the wall that says, dreams are visions of things that can become a reality. And I began to realize that in my 40s, that if you keep the dreams real, ask God to help you fulfill them, he will. And for the lack of better English, if you think you ain't, you can't. If you think you can, you will. And that's the kind of philosophy that I've lived by. And then I don't know who gave it to me. One of my customers gave me a serenity prayer when I was in my 30s. And you know about the serenity prayer.
Yes, sir.
God grant me serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
Yes, sir.
And we miss that a lot of times.
Mm-hmm.
And we make a mistake by telling young people, hey, you can do anything you want to do. That's true in part.
Mm-hmm.
You can do anything you want to within your mental and physical capabilities.
That's right.
Because we all have different talents or different skills. County commissioner gave me a name. He called me. He said, I'm the Renaissance man. He said, meaning that you can do a multitude of things. And yes, I cook. I've been in real estate. I built a brand new car wash back in 1983. And then from that, I opened up a catering business. And then I opened up the barber college. I was the second black to build a barber college in San Antonio. The first
Praise
black
the Lord.
To build a commercial building on W.W. White Road in 1972. That itself was an experience for me. It was a challenge.
You must have felt like Noah many days in your life.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm going to tell you a story about one. When I was in the process of building and getting a loan to build that building on W.W. White Road, because it was only white folk out there, no blacks and browns in terms of owning property. On W.W. White Road. Mm-hmm. There was a couple of blacks before me that was renting buildings out there, but nobody's actually bought land and built a building. So, man, about 6 months into it, one morning I was eating breakfast, and my wife said to me, she said, man, you were sure sweating last night. Your pillow was just soaking wet. And I looked at it, I said, you call it sweat if you want to. I'll cry it all night. I just had to reach the point where I said, Lord, what am I doing? I got myself out of here. How am I going to be able to handle it?
Mm-hmm.
And just before dawn, the voice comes and says, yes, you can.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you can. Get your butt up and get on out of here and get on it, you know. So it just let me know that life is for real. And that's another quote that we use loosely. But life really is what you make it by the choices and the decisions that you make, you see?
Yes, sir.
And once you make them, you got to stay with them.
Yes,
and you can't worry about what somebody else say or what somebody else think, because God gives you that vision. It doesn't belong to anybody else. It belongs to you. And when they say, I can't see it, don't bother me. You ain't supposed to see it because it's not for you. It's kind of like...
You sound like my 84-year-old auntie.
Well,
she said, God knows your mailbox. He don't have to give somebody else your message.
Yeah, and then I coined the phrase when people come to me with negative stuff and saying something about somebody. I said, look, this ain't no garbage dump. Take it somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Don't bring that over here. So we fall prey to a lot of things. And then, bless his heart, Claude Black gave me one. He said... you know, Charles, as black folk, we let our emotions get in the way of our better judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Don't let your emotion get in the way of your better, because we all get emotional about things,
you know.
Right. Mm-hmm. But your better judgments tell me, no, that ain't necessarily true. And you got to be strong enough to believe that, because the devil is a powerful man, a woman. And they can do some things that'll make you wonder, or make you go,
Mm-hmm.
But you got to understand that when you think about it, really know who you are, understand what your mission is, what you're trying to do, and that doesn't fit, you got to say, no, you got to stop somewhere else. You can't hang here. Because it can make it sound awful convincing. You can't do that. You don't have the money. You don't have the support. You don't have the knowledge. And you start thinking about that, and you start doubting. But you cannot do that. I believe if you can conceive it, you can deliver on it, you see? And so we have to understand that sometimes we make a mistake. Well, I don't know why you want to do that. Ain't nobody else ever done it. Well, why not?
Because nobody else ever did it.
Yeah, that's the reason I want to do it.
That's
a challenge. Why not, you see? I also was the... first black person to chair the state barber board as chairman of the whole state of Texas.
Wow.
And I did not.
A lot of history.
And I accepted that humbly and proudly, because I knew now I'm in a position to make a difference for people who look like me, because prior to me, All the chairperson had been white folk, nobody black. And we had some unique, different problems from white barbers and even some upscale Mexican-American barbers. Yeah. We have two things that people don't know about the barber industry. In the white industry, they call themselves hairstylists. Mm-hmm. And whole family go. In the black and brown community, men always go to the barber shop, mm-hmm. not the beauty shop. Mm-hmm. And it's an insult to him when you tell him he's going to, because I don't know what you call it, a macho thing or whatever it is, mm-hmm. but we just go. And one of the reasons is because that's our comfort zone. Mm-hmm. We can sit and talk and discuss about things that normally right. we couldn't. So barbershops serve many purposes, it's not only just to get a good haircut, as a community facility where you can vent and talk yeah. about things that you normally wouldn't be able to, because your barber's kind of free to do that because he's his own boss.
Yeah, in our day, they were our therapists.
Yeah, yeah.
The barber was our therapist. We didn't know what therapy was. So, we'd go there and then.
So that's kind of way that happened. And I tell people all the time that your dreams belong to you and nobody else. And even family sometimes. I remember one time Reverend Black was preaching a sermon and he said, you know, you got to beware of the devil. And you got to call him out and acknowledge him when you see him or her. Mm-hmm. And then he paused. He said, because you could be sleeping with him. Huh?
I can say amen to that one.
So you got to keep it real. And that also tells you that you can't let your feelings get in the way of your better judgment. And running the barber college, that was an awesome experience with young people who were searching and looking for life, trying to understand who they were and is this what I really wanted to do? And I had several, but one young man in particular who had good skills, but he was heavily in love with a young lady that didn't want him. Mm. It was obvious to me and everybody else except him. and I'll admit she was very attractive. And I told him one day, I said, look, we need to talk. His name was Clarence. I said, Clarence, we need to talk. So one day I told him, come on in the office. And I said, I can't remember her name, but we just said, I said, you really loved you. Yeah, Miss Weaver, I just can't live without her. I said, so if she just absolutely closed the door and walked out, you telling me you're ready to die? He said, well, not really, but life would be so difficult. I said, look, man, let me tell you something. And you got to brace yourself for this. She don't want you. I'm telling you as a friend. I'm telling you as a father figure. I said, you heard the expression, ways and action speaks louder than words?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I said, when the last time she told you she loved me? She never told me that.
Oh, my.
I said, when the last time she did something extra special for you? I don't remember. I said, well, don't that tell you something? Love is something you do, not something you say.
That's right.
And I know he wasn't like me. He sat there and he listened to me. He said, well, have you ever been deeply in love? I said, I don't know. I question it. I said, because I ain't never loved nobody where I feel like I couldn't live without him.
That's right.
I ain't never loved nobody where I couldn't eat baby back ribs because of
nobody.
I ain't never loved nobody where I can't get out of bed in the morning because my heart hurt.
I know,
so that's why I answer you like that.
Right.
I ain't never had that kind of love,
right.
And I have not.
Right.
And I thank God, please don't put it on me. I don't want that kind of love, you know.
Right.
But that's
right.
Keeping it real.
That is keeping it real. Yeah. Now, this was a dream.
Yes.
And how long did it take for it to come to fruition?
Well, it was about a 30-year dream. I started thinking some 30 years ago what a shame it would be for people who not to know about brave women and men who did, ordinary folk who did extraordinary things to make this community better. People like the names of G.J. Sutton, Claude Black, Harry Burns, Velmo Bellinger, Hattie Briscoe, Eugene Coleman, Mr. Davis, Mr. Pines, people who walked the picket lines, people who went to City Hall and argued with the mayor and the city council person to have ugly words hurled at them and called the N-word. People who, in the middle of the night, somebody would pass by their house and shoot at the house. People who had crossed, and history don't report this, but I'm telling you, it happened right here in San Antonio.
I believe it.
People who had not one, but three cross burned in their front yard during the night, just before dawn. It'd be a shame for people not to know about that, and not to know that they somehow were able to press forward under adverse conditions. And I think it's because they knew God, and they were committed to the cause. And one of the problems we have nowadays is it's hard to find people that will seriously commit themselves to a cause or to something significant. It's easy to latch on to something when it's popular. Difficult to hang when it becomes unpopular. But if that's your calling, you got to hang. Great athletes are great because they go the extra mile. They practice when everybody else is asleep. They take chances that teammates sometimes don't want to take. That's why they're great. But they also understand, though, the significance of teamwork. No matter how great the running back is, no matter how great the quarterback is, when we lose, we all lose.
That's right.
When we win, we all win. And black folk, I got to tell you, we got to grasp that. And minorities, we got to grasp that, because it's all about me, what I can do, who I am.
That's what.
And we forget about the rest of us. In particular, those of us who are appointed to high boards and commissions and win elections, once we get in there, we forget who put us in office. And all of a sudden, we're just concerned about self-aggrandization, what I can do for me, rather than thinking about the people that put you in office. I've seen that, and I've had to deal with people that have done that to me, you know. Put them in the office, when I go to them for them advice, they kind of like turn a cold shoulder to me. Oh, they tell me, I don't want to hear that. You're old and folkism. This is a new day. And I'm going like, man, don't you understand? You wouldn't have won this election if I hadn't been out there supporting you. That doesn't matter. And that's the sad part about humanity nowadays in time. We are ungrateful and unappreciative to those who paved the way for us. So that's part of my dream here, to make sure that I didn't forget about these people who paved the way for me. And I just called a name off, you see, that had integrity. When they built Lakeside far southeast of San Antonio, I was riding in the car with the developer and Reverend Black one day, and he was on the city council, and one of the developers said to him, see, Claude, has six floor plans here. Pick the one you want. We'll build you a house at cost. Won't cost you a dime over what we put in it to build it. And he gracefully took it and said, thank you. But about 2 weeks later, I asked him, I said, Reverend, did you ever pick out your floor plan? He said, oh, no, Brother William, I can't do that. He said, I got to be accessible to my members. I can walk to some of my members' house. I move way out there, they get sick in the night. I can't get to them, they can't get. And I thought, my God, how unselfish, because I know a whole lot of us would have been out there in a heartbeat. Would have left Wyoming Street. He was living in Wyoming. They'd have left Wyoming as soon as the house was built. You see what I'm saying? So I was encouraged by people who had integrity, who really believed in the dream, you see? And if I can say this, and I am, Dr. King's dream really did come true for a while. We got better jobs, better education, better homes, better cars, and more money in the bank. So the dream did work. Leading up to the election of a black man who won the presidency by the name of Barack Obama. And that's when a certain segment of this country said, whoa, dream got to stop here. That's too much. We got to cut the dream off. This is too much. And ever since that gentleman, President Obama, was elected, we've been trying to turn the clock back. This dream has inspired minorities to get out of their place. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to be president of this country. Mm-hmm. You're not supposed to be CEO of this company. Mm-hmm. You're not supposed to be a general in the army. Mm-hmm. You're not supposed, that's not your place.
And I wanna,
but that's where the dream put us, you see.
And I want to say this too, in addition to what you're saying, Mr. Williams, is that no matter who else is trying to stop us, we have to come back to be a united force.
Yeah.
Because we're only as strong as our weakest link.
Yes.
When we start dividing ourselves, we're a house that's divided against ourselves. We can't stand anyway.
Yes, yes.
You mentioned earlier moving out to other areas instead of being the light and salt in the area you are.
Yeah.
To make a difference, to really make a difference in the transformation means I take the old and I make something new out of it.
Yeah.
And that's very difficult to do when I can't relate to it anymore.
Yes, yes.
And so I want to say that we are living in a time, since you brought it up, okay, we are living in a time where we're going to have to learn to work together as people. We cannot allow people to divide us. We cannot, and I'm not just talking to black people. I'm talking to all people. There's one race in God's eyesight, and that's human race. We have to make up our minds that we're not going to let any institution divide us and stop us from living the lives that God intended for us to live. We have to make up our minds. Yes, we can have nice houses and cars and all of that kind of stuff, but we have a responsibility to one another, to take care of our elderly and to our young people, to help make sure we give them the tools and the platform that they might be able to live productive lives, to stop killing each other, to stop talking about each other, dissing each other, backstabbing each other, and all those other things, like stop selling each other drugs, stop stealing children. I mean, I could go on and that's another show. I get it. But y'all know me. We have to stop doing that. We have to make up our minds that we were created for peace. When God made Adam and Eve, we were not created for chaos. And we have to make up our minds that we want to restore that peace and that faith in our God and in each other so that we can build and make this country and make our communities better than they are today.
Yeah. Well, it begins also with dealing with reality and being able to handle the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Seem like truth has taken back seat to to lies and things that are not true. It seems like the better liar you are, the more acceptable you are, the more people like you. And it's easy to dance by that kind of music because of human nature, we all want to be liked. But I got to tell you, that's not what God intended for us to do.
Not what God intended.
You know, we got to stand on principles.
That's right.
And we've lost our moral compass in this country because we follow those where truth doesn't matter. We follow those who are mean and ugly. And we can't handle the truth about what's wrong and what's right.
And that's because we strayed away from God.
Yeah, and I got to tell you, you're absolutely right about that. Finally, it's so many quotes that I've learned and picked up over the years, and I learned to quote them verbatim. And one is that life is not measured by the number of breath that we take.
Mm-hmm.
But by the moment that takes that breath away.
Yeah.
And we have had a lot of breathtaking moments. When I saw President Johnson signing those civil rights bills into law, that was a breathtaking moment.
Yeah.
When I saw Dr. King standing there under the Lincoln Memorial talking about I had a dream, that was a breathtaking moment.
Yeah.
So those are the things that measures your life.
Mm-hmm.
Not longevity,
that's
but
right.
What you do with your life,
that's
you see.
Right.
And You can't always be self. We all are. And I'm not gonna lie. Yeah, they say self-preservation is the first law of nature. And if you don't look out for yourself, something wrong with you. But I got to tell you, in the process of helping others, you also help yourself.
Absolutely.
You also help yourself. And we don't always seem to understand that. And there's a lot of idiotic things that we are ingrained. It's been ingrained in us, and we don't think about it. For instance, I don't like Ron. Why? Well, he don't have no hair. Idiotic stuff. You know, I don't like the way he dressed. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, we hung up in too many.
Yeah, we hung on itty bitty stuff that don't make sense, you see.
Mr. Williams, we are running out of time.
Yes, and I got to get up out of here.
Do me a favor, because there's a lot of young men who didn't start off with a mom like yours. There's a lot of young men who didn't have a community like yours.
Yes.
There's a lot of men who didn't have, they had a dream, but they feel scared to fulfill that dream.
Yeah.
Can you talk to them for 1 minute for me right now?
Well, I just want to say to you, young men and young ladies, your dream belongs to you. And again, dreams are vision of things that can become a reality. So if the dream come to you, it's meant for you. And you've got to talk to somebody about it that you can honestly feel like trust you and you trust them. Then you got to be true with yourself and say, am I capable of doing this? Yes, I have this dream, but am I capable of doing this? Can I fulfill the whole thing? Now, let me say, you may not be able to. Life is kind of like putting a puzzle together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't worry about this one piece that you can't make fit. Just keep stepping in these other pieces, and guess what? When you get to the end, that piece that can't fit gonna be right in the middle.
Absolutely.
Life is the same way, see?
Absolutely.
So you can't get stumped because in the process of fulfilling a dream, you can't punch everything in place like you want to and think you ought to. You just keep punching enough things in place. When you get to the end, the one that you was missing gonna be right in the middle of it.
Be right there for you.
All right.
I dropped something and I can't add it. All right. Look, I want to say thank you so very much to Mr. Williams. He has been a great guest for me today. I am so excited that you were my first ever here in San Antonio. Praise be to God in my new place and live here at Williams Historical National Museum. I want to thank my producer, Mr. Ron Gordon, for working with me and giving me this opportunity. And I also want to say that I want you to remember, I have my new book out, 31 Days with the Word That Works in Jesus. Please go to Amazon.com and pick up your book. If you think that life is too hard, I promise you, if you have a will, God will make the way.
Yes.
You can overcome. This book talks about me coming through divorce, abuse, rejection, and closed doors, and so much more. I promise you, God will take you where he wants you to go. He that began a good work in us shall complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. You can rest assured that when you work the word of God, the word of God will work for you. Thank you again, Mr. Williams, and I want to bless you with this.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let me just, to those young people and young ladies that you told me, and I'll be as brief as I can.
Okay.
Back in the 30s, there was a young black man that left Mississippi, went to Chicago, seeking a better life. And his dream was to be the best dishwasher that you could be. And he journeyed up there because he had a sister living there. And when he got there, he told his sister, said, just tired of picking cotton, tired of doing demeaning work, and I want me a nice job where when it rains, it won't bother. When it gets too hot, I'm inside, I just want to be a good dishwasher. And she said, well, I'm gonna take you downtown to one of the leading hotels where you can get a job. And she carried him down there, talked with the guy. Guy conducted the interview. He said, well, I'll tell you what, the job is yours. So all you have to do is just sign right here. So you got to fill out a job application. So he sat there and he just kind of looked at the job application. The guy said, well, you going to fill out the job application? He said, sir, I don't know how to do it. He said, what you mean? He said, sir, I can't write.
I can't read.
He said, well, I'm sorry. You got to fill out the job application if you want a job here. I said, I'm sorry, I just can't help you. So he left somewhat dejected. Walking through the alley, he found a couple of wooden apple boxes. Took them to his sister's house, made him a shoe shine kit. Start shining shoes. 20 years later, this white guy sitting in the shine stand in this nice building, he was shining shoes and he tapped him on the shoulder and said, hey boy, do you know who owned this building? Yes, sir. Who owned this building? I do, sir. My God, you shining shoes and you own this building? Yes, sir. He said, well, I'm with Urban Renewal. We're gonna come through here, we're gonna buy this property, and we're gonna give you $100,000. Well, 50 years ago, that's a lot of money, still is today. And he said, yes. He said, well, by the way, what about the little building across the street? We've been eyeing that, we want that one. Do you know who owned that? Yes, sir. So who owned that? He said, I do, sir. He said, damn, it's pretty good for a shoe shine, man. He said, yes, sir. He said, well, I tell you what, give me about a month, I'm gonna send my limousine out here. I'm gonna buy these two buildings from you. And all you gotta do is come down to my office and sign the papers. And you got you $200,000. Yes, sir. Sure enough, 2 weeks later, sent the limousine out, picked him up, carried him down there. Guy read the paperwork to him and everything. So now all you got to do is just sign right here. And he marked with an X. Guy said, my God, you own all of that and you can't even read and write. I wonder what you would have been if you could read and write, he said, a dishwasher. So you see, he took what he had and made something out of it. Good evening.
Yes, great story, great story. And it's never where you start out, it's always where you end up. Thank you for watching. God bless you and join us again on next week. And we're gonna have my producer, Mr. Ronald Gordon will be my guest as we continue to talk about the great things that are occurring here in San Antonio here at WSANradio.com. God bless you.
You can clap.
All right, we at the end right now, and Eric, it was a beautiful thing. I love that.
Oh, great.
That was a story. That we just, I didn't know all that. Sit down and talk.
That's why I like to interview people.
We always think we can trip.
We think we know people. We don't know people.
And maybe you do the same thing. I was showing some things. When I went outside and seen that pit, I said, that's a very seasoned pit. He looked at me and said, we appreciate you, Dr. Lee and Charles Williams for the second right. We'll see you back next week. And at the same time, same bat channel, same bat place. All right, this is DJ Ron G. We're going to get out of here. Peace and chicken grease.
Lay back on this one.
I do, baby.
You only a customer when you walking in the presence of hustlers. I'm laid back in the cinnamon range. 2 decades and ain't a damn thing changed. Keep my girl the strawberry swirl. You can taste it, my instincts basic. Lord of mercy, sweet like Hershey. Kisses, diamonds for the misses. Ices on the wrists. All different colors of the spectrum. The smallest four, and I reject them. Believe me, I'm a connoisseur when I inspect them. Hop against them, invisibly sets them. They call me Big Ellie Walker from Compton to Yonkers. Those Chi-Town steppers and them A-Town stompers. These young rookies fail to understand. Every summer I return like the ice cream man. Drop what you doing, get it while you can. By the eighth, by the ounce, when it's gone, I'ma bounce. It's the FLAV, no ifs or maybes. You know what I do, drive your taste buds crazy.
Like lemon drops with chocolate,
we can't go wrong. Come on, baby, baby, come on. My flavor's unreal, smooth but hard like wood grain on the wheel. Recline your seat, baby, enjoy how it feel. Why you crossing your legs? Them high heels made of ill. Kick off your shoes, run your toes on the dash. Now peel off your stockings. Come on, let's get it popping. I'm in the mood for cotton, candy, and I'm plotting to see you in something soon. You see the move. Me too. Man, you know how we do. Camcorder main feature, damn, a preview. I love how the bottom on your body's EQ. Low but thick, yo, like the bass in a 6-4. So here we go. We bunny hopping. I hit the switches, baby. You keep it dropping. It feels marvelous. You in charge of this. I hope you ain't heartless, but my guard's down regardless. Mix me and you where we can't go wrong. Look better on you. What you really wanna do?
All I wanna show you, boy, that I taste good too.
I know you taste good, ma. What you saying? Wanna sprinkle up the hood, huh? We had it out. I tell you girls the truth when they ask what I'm about. The cookies and the cream and the peaches and pralines. Butter pecan themes in your daydreams. All real sugar, no saccharine. Low calorie, leave no cavities. Guaranteed no place you'd rather be than here with me mixing chocolate in the factory. Mix me and you and we can't go wrong.
WSAN Radio, San Antonio.
Yeah, it's the Pied Piper of R&B, y'all. Whoa. Follow me. Yeah. Chicago and them.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Don Juan and them.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. This is for y'all. Remix.
Said I know that it's somebody's birthday tonight. Somewhere, and I know somebody's gonna celebrate tonight. Somewhere, I know
one thing's for sure.
I'm gonna put on my dancing shoes,
then I'ma hit the door
and go out and step the whole night through. Champagne somewhere, and you can be sure that
be sure
somebody's gonna make love night until the day. Oh,
one thing's for sure.
I'm gonna put on my dancing shoes,
then I'ma hit the door
and go out and step the whole.
Yeah,
I wanna be the first one to hit the floor.
So
tell the DJ to turn it up.
Turn it up.
Cause it feels so good. Dancing to this remix makes me wanna step. Cause it's a cut.
Step,
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 step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step, step
side to side, round and round, step it now.
Come on and step in the name of love.
Now let me see you.
George Daniels, I love you, baby.
Let me see you do.
Harry Love, I see you. DJ Wayne Williams, spinning the records. Make sure you spin this one, baby. All right. And last but not least, let's not forget the most talented man in the world on the guitar. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Donnie Lyle. Say on.